It's not, yeah, the reason why it's not a finite volume is not because of this, but because of this.
Oh, that's more fun. Okay.
Okay.
So it's false for an interesting reason, not a silly reason.
Yeah.
Okay.
yeah. It's a good point. Yeah. And actually, in this case, it's when it's larger than 4, it's just exactly the case, right? Like you have components of it. So it's not very interesting in this case. Okay. So, state the definition for higher dimensions. So what we want to consider is subgroup of some matrix groups. So gamma is subgroup of GR, let's say G and Z. And we consider that it's there's a closure, so in the examples I gave here, the risky closure is always SL to 1. But in general, it can be a bit more, a bit different. It can be any sub group of zero. Okay, and now we say. We say gamma is thin. So it is a finite index in its direct curve. So is this right? Oh, in here? Yes.
Oh, wait. So it's a you're saying it's thin in G. You forget GLM. It's a condition on how gamma sits inside of G, right?
Yes.
But
so in this
I thought you wanted it in fact the opposite. You want it to be an infinite coline.
Yes, you want to
it's not, I guess it's not only about the index, I mean for small n. I mean, depending what g is, mm-hmm. right? It's also okay. No, I see.
So it's just a generalization of what we're doing here. Here we just have Zariski dense subgroups, and you can just think as of g as any D group you like, and you take some integer matrix subgroup that is very dense in this D group, and you want to check if it has finite or infinite index in the integer matrices of this D group. Okay. So you can play this game. So it's a very similar game. But you can do it for example, for matrices in SP parsing. So let's look at what happens in SP parsing. So Chris will be happy to see the same number. So let's say. So you have an example here.
Is it 10?
I think it's 10.
Do you want something finite order and something uniform?
Yes, it's because. It's
oh, no, that's the transaction.
Yeah. But yeah, this one is a. So it's a theorem of Chris and Thomas. So this group is. Yes, 0, 0, 0.
It's what are these matrices? So
it's a complement matrix.
What do you call them? The rational canonical form. It's the rational canonical form of some matrix of order 5 whose roots are the non-trivial fifth roots of unity.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, anyway, the point of my talk today would be to explain some a bit further these kind of examples. So the idea here is that it's usually hard to find examples of thin groups. I mean, actually, it's hard to decide whether or not they are thin or thick. And I will explain some link with Lyapunov exponents that give at least a numerical criterion to find thin groups, examples of thin groups. Okay. So let me talk about Lyapunov exponents. So I'll come back to this later. Okay.
So. Yeah, I guess maybe you'll come to it, but this example is not just constructed so that the theorem is true, it's something that arises in nature. The example arises in nature. And you don't just construct
it.
It's not like you just construct it so that the theorem was true. I mean, if all you wanted to do was give examples of thin groups, this would be pretty easy to do. Yeah, and I think they're even generic, like, it's sort of generically true if you choose two things at random.
Yeah, so here they arise as monodromy groups. That's what is interesting for us. So, we want to explain this. Okay.
So one way you know, sorry. Once the group gets big enough, something like SP4, then there are theorems of Margulis that say that all the finite index subgroups are actually arithmetic, and they are all the finite covalent groups are in fact arithmetic and they're rigid, you can't deform them. So that tells you they're very non-generic. And so if you just choose matrices at random and they generate some big group, then they'll almost certainly be thin. You'd have to be really lucky to generate an arithmetic group by choosing matrices randomly, because they kind of come in discrete families. And then, so that's a heuristic, but then it's actually a theorem of Fougeron and, Fuchs. You can sort of quantify this. It's really, generating a group randomly will produce a thin group in the search field.
Okay. The game we want to play now is the problem. So we start with some hyperbolic surface. And we define some flat connection. Flow. So, geodesic flow. So, generalized representation of the fundamental group of my surface to some point z. So the flat bundle will be defined with respect to this as take the universal cover and so you can create artificially this flat bundle just using this representation. Surface and you can transport. So if you take your vector in the fiber, there is a way to transport it along geodesics. So that's what we will do. Like we will consider this kind of some vector v here, and we transport it along geodesic. Using the flat connection. Okay, and so the question we ask is how does the norm of such a vector behaves?
I mean, you also need to choose the tension function. I mean, there are many geodesics.
Yeah,
it's always defined on the.
Yes. Yes. Mango. Yeah. Sure. Okay, and so now you have. So the claim is that this will behave as some to grow with some exponents. So kind of exponentially with some exponents. So there is a theorem of oscillators. That there is a flag decomposition above almost every point on the surface of this flat bundle. Such as this norm behaves as exponential of some exponents t for any for all vector in this. Okay, so the idea here is just what you should have in mind is imagine you have let's start with a much simpler case. Imagine you just have some matrix and you look at the power of this matrix. So and if you multiply by some vector, how will the norm of this vector behave? Right. So this will be if you take generically your vector here, this will behave as the largest exponent. So you're now just eigenvalue of this m, the m times and the norm of the okay. And the idea here is that you just want to, if you take like a vector in the second eigenspace, this will behave not with the first eigenvalue, but with respect to the second eigenvalue. So that's your flag decomposition. If you have first eigenspace, second one. And for any vector that is not in the second eigenspace, you see that it will be attracted to this direction. Except if you go exactly in the second eigenspace.
Yeah. So what about the metric which you chose on your local system? I mean, the exponents, because they depend on the metric.
Yeah, I don't understand exactly what the flow is on V.
Okay, so.
So I understand what it is on T because you have a metric on the surface.
Yes.
And then on V.
So V is a flat bundle.
Yeah.
Yeah, but there is no metric.
I mean, the metric on the V. Yeah. So that's right.
So how do you get the flow on V?
The flow on V is clear. You just use
the flat connection.
Okay.
The thing where I was shading a little bit is that this norm is not well defined. Like you have to choose, a theory you have to pick some norm. The thing is, in this case, as you see that there is some log that appears when you compute this kind of exponents, and it doesn't really depend on the it only depends on the class of the norm. And if you are on a compact surface, then it doesn't depend on the norm.
So the exponents doesn't depend on
the norm.
On the norm?
Yes.
And does it depend on theta, for example?
No.
Okay, but it's also not
it's, I mean, yeah, the theorem is for almost all the theta,
mm-hmm.
and for almost all the you have like, the same. So yeah, it's exactly, it's part of the theorem to say that it doesn't depend on all of the things. So because of, like, well, this comes from the ability of the hyperbolic general hyperbolic flow. Okay. Good.
So for the theorem, it's important that this is the basis of the work.
Yes. Yeah, you need some hyperbolicity on the base.
But look, I don't.
Okay. Okay, so let me give you an example of such a setting. So now I want to talk about hypergeometric equations. So, let's start with some. Okay. I'm considering a class of linear differential equations. So there are students, there have been studies because of, they appear quite naturally in physics. So for this kind of differential equations, we can see that they are singular. So at 3 points, at 0, 1, and infinity. So for infinity, you have to consider a little bit. Again, it's true. And what you can do is, okay, it's an ordinary differential equation on the plane, and it's singular on 0 and 1 and infinity. And so what you can do is, okay, it's a degree 2 differential equation, so in a neighborhood of any point on the plane that are not the singularities, you have a vector space of dimension 2 of solutions for these equations. And usually when you have differential equations, it is a flat bundle, because if I fix the solution at some point, I can identify locally all of these solutions, right? If I fix conditions of the differential equations, I know all of the functions. So the idea is that I can prolong any solution of this equation in neighborhood, and I can do it like such a way that I can turn it on 0. Yeah. And so when I come back from where I started, there will be some monodromy on the space of solutions. Okay, so just imagine that there is a vector space here of dimension 2. I identify the solutions locally, and when I come back, there is no reason why a solution should come exactly to the same one. So there is a linear application that will change solution when it turns on the point. So it's just the picture that you should have in mind is just for logarithm. Right? When I turn on 0 for logarithm, I add a 12 pi to the function. So that there is some random. Okay. And so for this kind of equations, the idea here is that you have three matrices that correspond to what happened when I turn on the three singularities. Okay, so I can associate to these equations monodromy matrices and 0, 1, and infinity that are the monodromy around singularities. And the picture you should have in mind is the following. So it defines a flat bundle over C minus 3 points, over C minus 2 points. So which is a sphere minus 2 points, right? So that's what it looks like. It's
a plane minus 3.
Sorry?
Yeah, sphere minus 3
points. Plane minus 2.
Exactly. Plane minus 2 or sphere minus 3. Yeah. Is it better? Yeah. Okay, so it looks like this, right? So just, if I use the hyperbolic, they are crisp. And I can play the same game, like, turn around this crisp and then go, I don't know, this kind of thing. Okay. Good.
And that's not something you can call by A, B, and C, right? I mean, you have terms here.
That depends on the equation, yes. Mm-hmm. Oh, so there is a nice remark is that, well, you see that if I multiply, and yeah, the matrices only depend on the path I make from this point. So you can see that if I turn around 0, then around 1, and then around 50, gives me a trivial path. So for the of those three matrices will be identical. That's remarked.
Okay. That's flatness.
What?
That's flatness. Right, it's a homotopy invariance of.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
A parallel transport.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. So there is a game you can play, so you can look at all of these, this family of equations, and compute the Lyapunov exponents. So yeah, I did some computer experiments, and you can just observe what happens. Okay. But the interesting part in this class of equations is that they have some extra structure, which is that they have this property of being rigid, which implies that they have variation of half structure. So let me explain what is a variation of half structure in a few words. So it's a bit of a challenge.
I'm sorry, it's still about the self-derived, right?
What?
You talk about the sphere without points, it is about the self-derived, and it's not about the space.
So these matrices, they are in a GL2, GL2, well, C,
apparently? Yeah, GL2, yeah, and GLN, if I know GLN, how do you connect
with that? Okay, yeah, that's a good question. So my claim is that there is a natural generalization of this class of equations of degree of higher degree, and the degree will determine exactly the dimension of the problem. Right? If you have a configuration of degree 3, the space of dimension will be of dimension 3.
The space of solutions.
Of solutions, exactly.
But I will have probably more points
than
if it's
higher.
It can still be just 3 points.
Yeah, I can write down the question if you want, but it's points. Yeah. You can do it. That's my thing.
Isn't any local system on CP1 minus 3 points is a system of solutions of cartogenic? Or the equation of this?
No, it's not true because.
Because it's
in particular, this is rigid.
Ah, all of those are rigid.
Yeah.
I see. And it's true that all the rigid representations.
This I don't know. Chris, you know?
So I'm not sure. The answer is in this book of cats on which it was. Whatever the answer is, it must be on the first page.
So the metric is on the base. So you always have three matrices, zero corresponding to the monodromy and 0, 1, okay. So it gives you a representation of P1 of, it's P1 minus 3 points. Okay. And so this defines, and this is equal to the P1 of. These three matrices define this representation. And so this defines flat bundle over this P minus one. Okay.
And the metric is called?
Yeah, and the metric, yeah, that's the point. Like, it's a Riemann surface, and you have a canonical hyperbolic metric you can put on it. Okay. So you can associate the Lyapunov exponents in these objects. Okay.
So I'm pretty sure the answer is yes to this question.
Yeah.
Good. Yeah. So you can assume that the three singular points are at 0, 1, and infinity just by the change of variables. Right? You can always move three points to 0, 1, and infinity. And then rigidity means that once you know the three monodromy matrices, you know the local system. Once you know the Jordan normal forms of the three, then you know the local system, and if you know that, you can write there's some lemma of some guy named Level that says triples of the formula A times B times C equals identity matrix, where the Jordan normal forms are specified,
mm-hmm.
can always be conjugated to some standard form,
mm-hmm.
and from that standard form you can read off the equation.
Mm-hmm.
So this is all in explicit in some notes of some guy named Boykers.
Okay. Okay, so here comes the new object. It's a version of first one. It's of an abstract algebraic object on flat bundles. But I just want to give a notion where it comes from. So the idea is quite simple. It's like you start with, let's say, a surface that will parameterize other surfaces. So let's say, for example, well, you know, there is like this, the modular surface. Well, at least the modular polyphones. And the idea is that each point of this polyphone corresponds to some Riemann surface here at Taurus. Right. And what you want to do is for each of these points, you want to look at the Hodge the cohomology of this surface. Okay, so this will define a bundle, a vector bundle of this surface. Right, so above each of these points, you have, so each point corresponds to a Riemann surface, and then you can consider it's a cohomology group. And so this will associate a vector bundle above each point of the base. Okay? Yeah? Okay. And so now what you want to do is that so let's be a bit more detailed. You know, like, rational space for genus 1, it's just H2. So when you have the upper half plane with a parameterized Riemann structure on the torus, so in the following way, so a path plane is just determines a vector, and it has a unit horizontal vector, and each of these vectors will correspond to a nice structure on a nice Riemann structure on the torus, just by identifying the torus with this flat representation. And so what I'm saying is that each of these points corresponds to a Riemann structure on the torus, and so I can also look at bundle over it, which is just considering the first cohomology group of this surface. Okay. And so now the idea here is that I have a base, so some surface. And above each of the points, I have a vector bundle that you should think of as a cohomology group. Okay. So I think there is a natural flat connection in this. It is called co-spanning connection. I don't want to enter too much into details, but moreover, on cohomology group of Riemann surfaces, you have a natural decomposition. Coming from Hodge theory, which is given by holomorphic and anti-holomorphic one-forms. So it's just, yeah. If you have never heard about this before, it's just, you can forget about it in a minute. You have some decomposition, and the idea here is that when you have this kind of moduli spaces of the complex varieties, you like most of the time you will have some decomposition of the bundle defined by the cohomology group. And the idea here is that you will have a filtration. So yeah, you will have this kind of things.
Sorry, again.
Yes.
On the each we have surface and on each point what fiber is.
Yeah, yeah, I mean it's a bit so there are it's a bit in
well each point corresponds to a surface.
Yes.
And the fiber is
the
first
cohomology
of
the
this
surface.
Of, this surface.
Yes, exactly. So it's a bit you see you have a surface at the base that parameterize surfaces.
Yes.
And so each point is a surface,
yes.
Riemann surface. And you can consider the cohomology group of this surface. So it's very close.
There's a fibration over this genus G surface whose fibers are, surfaces of some other genus. And,
yeah.
And you look at how cohomology varies in these fibers. And the fact that the family is locally trivial topologically means you can identify cohomology of this fiber with that fiber.
Yeah,
okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
But the one space is not a surface, it would be
big. Yeah, it can be heavier, it can be wider.
So it is whoa.
But I imagine
on the bottom it's what for the modular space, yes?
For what?
It's each for the modular space.
Yeah, yeah, it's a picture. It can, yeah. Usually it's much wider, right? You can have space. But if you have that, you can have this kind of thing.
But does every solution give you a
good means? It
does what?
So here, in this case, I don't have any one of space. I only have like this sphere and this frequency. And a flat bundle over it. And now what I'm claiming is that I'm considering the bits of a different setting where you have a base, at the base some modular space. So again, I can also have a sphere and a sequence. But here, each point will correspond to some complex manifold. And on this complex manifold, I have a natural flat bundle I can associate taking the homology space. And now the very nice thing about this kind of flat bundles is that there is a natural decomposition of this flat bundle, coming from Hodge theory. Okay. And so this is a motivation for introducing some extra structure on the flat bundles, which is exactly having some kind of decomposition on the flat bundles. So that's what we call version of our structures. Yeah. So the definition is a bit involved. I don't want to say much more. Let's say the idea is that you have some flat bundle and you can decompose it with a holomorphic subbundle and anti-holomorphic. And there is a very nice theorem that states the following. So if you have a flat bundle that have this kind of decomposition here. So maybe H10 and H01. So you should remember that this is a holomorphic subbundle, the flat bundle. Okay? So you have so the dimension of this is 2G. And so you will have 2G in of exponents. Okay. And the thing is, as you have an extra structure coming from the version of our structure, so there is some symplectic form. And we imply that the Lyapunov exponents will be symmetric in the sense that, maybe my notation is not. So the lambdas are the Lyapunov exponents I introduced in the beginning. And in the case of I have a symplectic form that will imply some symmetry on the Lyapunov exponents. And so the thing I can consider is the form. I can look at the sum of the positive Lyapunov exponents. And so there is a kind of a magic theorem that will relate these dynamical invariants with some algebraic invariants coming from these variational constraint.
So, sorry, before we get there,
yeah.
Something I'm confused about is the hyperbolic structure on your pictures. What's one way to get it? The fundamental group is free. So, and say we fix it. I guess once we fix a complex structure on it, and an order. So we can take the universal cover as a complex manifold that happens to look like a disk. Because that's the only thing on which a free group is going to act freely. But there are lots of ways to embed a free group on two generators and two SL2R.
Mm-hmm.
So that looks like if you get different hyperbolic metrics on this, do they all turn out to be isometric? Or I mean, you can realize this as a quotient of us of the half-time in lots of different ways.
I mean, like the representation was when you define this representation, you need to mark the structure, like you need to understand what is the a loop around zero.
No, so that's a topological question.
Yes.
I also want a metric, right?
Yes.
So how can I get a metric on it? Well, whatever, I see. So if I take a uniformization, if I take a universal cover, that will also have a metric, but it will just have to be isometric to the disk if it was hyperbolic. But then that will give me an embedding of the fundamental group of this into the group of automorphisms of the disk, of isometries of the disk, which is what PSA is required. But there are lots of different sets of metrics.
No?
What?
Yeah.
There are no
modules.
There are no
modules.
All of them are isomorphic. You have only one hyperbolic metric for each conformal structure, to the same conformal structure, and there is only one conformal structure with one or two points.
Okay.
Okay, so that means you can fix this term.
So that's an algebraic fact which is not called like this.
Okay, well, we should call dimensions or one dimension.
So you have a holomorphic subbundle of this lab bundle. And you can consider, so you have a holomorphic bundle over a Riemann surface. And you can consider its degree. And so the theorem is that the sum of the positive Lyapunov exponents is equal to the degree of this subbundle, renormalized by some constant, that is, some topological constant. And it's a theorem by, so it was first observed by Zorich. Numerically, and proved by Konsevich, and Bonn.
Sorry, to the right, on the left, that's h to the power 2g on the upper right corner.
What is that? Sorry.
On the upper right corner of the left, should be right h to the power 2g.
This?
You mean to the left.
To the left.
To the left.
H to the power 2g.
H
and the slot
2g? Yeah.
No, this was just an example of. So it's. My claim is that the upper half plane is a dashed space for genus 1 Riemann surfaces.
Okay, yeah, but this is.
Well, it's example for genus 1.
Yes.
Okay. For genus G, 2G.
Mm, well, it's, it doesn't generalize like this. It's, so you have Teschner spaces in higher objects, but it's more, I mean, the topology is much more difficult.
Okay, but it's
it's not more difficult than that.
And he's a function.
But it's not this.
He's a function of what?
Sorry?
He's a function of what? Which
what's chi?
Chi.
Chi. What is chi? The denominator.
Oh, k is.
Well, what is the base?
So k is just the Euler characteristic of the base.
Euler characteristic.
Okay.
Of what?
Of the base.
Of the base.
Yeah. So in this case, it's this. Maybe one.
So it doesn't depend. You mean chi doesn't depend on the bundle of the base?
Doesn't depend on
what? On the bundle.
No, yeah, it's okay. It depends only on the topology of the base.
And I might have missed. So from hypergeometric equation, you obtained the local system, which is rigid, therefore underlies the variation of Hodge structures. But is it always wave one variation?
No, exactly. So that's my point.
So, but the theorem only holds for wave one.
Yes. So that's the point of the top. So in wave one, it's very nice because we have an equality between these two points. And the question is, yeah, exactly what happens in the case of higher waves. So you see here, I was considering cohomology group, first cohomology group, but you can also try, I mean, if your monthly space parameterized higher dimension complex varieties, you can look at higher dimension cohomology groups. And so you can try to look at weights too. So, yeah, it's probably, this is weight one. So let's see what happens to wave 2. So there is also a theorem by CMP, which has a very similar behavior. So, well, let's say it's H2, and you have some decomposition like this. So into two spaces. So in this case, you assume that you have some particular symmetry. So these are the dimensions of the subspaces. And if you assume such a thing, the theorem of Semin and Filip is that the first Lyapunov exponent is always equal to the degree of this H2 0 of chi. Okay, so in way 2, it also generalizes. You have some equality, like between some dynamical invariant and some algebraic invariant. And so and then it gets interesting, it becomes a bit more interesting in the case of weight 3, because there is a very general theorem by Eskin. Very specific differential equations. The theorem states that the sum of the first two Lyapunov exponents, so it's not equal anymore, it's bounded below by the degrees of the subspaces H3-0 and H2-1. So in the case of higher weights, you don't have equality anymore, but you have an inequality, and this theorem is actually much more general than just the hypergeometric equations. Okay? And so now, of course, the natural question is whether or not there is equality. So the question is, when is there equality? So it was observed numerically that so they considered some very specific cases of the hypergeometric equations that are parameterized by two parameters, u1 and u2, and that have this very specific property that so the representation of the fundamental group of the sphere matrix sequence is in SP4 of Z. And so they have considered numerically 14 examples that are quite well known. And in these 14 examples, it seems that half of them were equality cases and the other half were inequality cases. And the theorem of Chris Brad and Thomas is, I mean, at that point was very surprising because it corresponded, it was stating exactly that the cases that seemed to be equality cases were exactly the thin groups for the monodromy group. So,
and what's sigma 3?
It's just a way to write CP1. It's still it's still an example of hypergeometric equations, but of higher dimension.
But all the theorems you mentioned, so what do I assume about the base? That the hyperbolic.
I think so. You are safe if you assume that it's a hyperbolic surface. And probably it's also true for Kähler manifolds, but this is kind of, it's not written. So if it's a compact Kähler manifold, it's true because of theorems of Doron Daniel. But
hyperbolicity also.
So you can also introduce a point of exponents just with the Brian motion.
Let's stick
with the hyperbolic case.
And also, I mean, so for the weight one case, you have G positive and G negative. So I mean, is G the same as the genus?
Yes.
So the number of Lyapunov exponents equals the genus.
Yes.
So, and is, I mean, what, why is it so?
The genus and the fiber.
Yeah. You mean the Lyapunov flag is all of them have it's like,
yeah, because you have
a single dimensional one. I mean it's not clear to me that there's G Lyapunov exponents, that there are G terms in the flag.
I think it's clear and
or is it part
because this is in this case let's say it's cohomology group of genus G.
So that's the theorem, the quotient there, one dimensional.
Up to multiplicity, but you can always assume that there are exactly the number of
exponents
that are the dimension. But sometimes you will repeat.
Yeah,
yeah, I got it. So yeah, here I agree.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I want to. Is it? Are we? Yeah. I didn't keep track of the time. I'll finish quickly. So the question was so this family that they were considering, it's it depends only on two parameters. The hypergeometric equation, you have seen there are some parameters that I wrote was there were I, B, and C. But in the case of dimension, in the case we are considering that, you can restrict yourself to only two parameters. So, and what was interesting is that if you draw the points, so mu1 and mu2 are here, and so if you draw the points for the 14 examples, now look at this.
So mu's are lambdas, or
what?
What are mu's?
Mu is just the parameters for the equations. So it's parameters giving the differential equations, the hypergeometric equations.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. So you can draw the points in it. And so at first the conjecture was that, again, when you do the experiments, all of the points above this line were the equality points, the equality cases. And all of the other points below were strict inequality. So the conjecture was that, maybe it's just the region that decides if there is equality or not. But I did some experiments, and you can see that it's actually wrong. So it seems that the equality cases are much more rare. So it happened it seems that there are very few equality cases, and they are kind of isolated. And so if you run some experiments with the Lyapunov exponents, you can try to find. I had some pictures on the computer, but I think it would be great. So what happens on this thing? If you draw the difference between the Lyapunov exponents and the quantity I wrote there, as you can compute with some algebraic computations, it looks like this. So you have some oscillation. And the idea here is that.
Sorry, where is this picture taken from?
Yes. So this is along this line.
Uh-huh.
So I have a parameter here and this T.
And move along this line, and then
this is the plot is just the difference between the two cases.
Yeah. Okay.
So what I'm looking for is just the zeros.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
And so the thing is like there are some known zeros, like these three points. But the other points are, you can find numerically some other points. There's an infinite family of equality cases.
What? The slope of
this
line?
The slope?
Yeah.
The slope of this line?
The slope.
It's some rational number.
Ah,
it's. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so the question was, so we suspect the equality cases to be for thin monodromy groups. So the question is, can you show that these points correspond to thin monodromy groups? So that's what we did with Simon Filip. So.
I mean, it's contrary to my intuition, but I would have thought that thin is generic.
Yeah, well, yeah, maybe it's quite surprising as well.
Okay.
Yeah. But it's clear, if you do the experiments, it's clear that it's not generic.
Well, the quality is not generic.
Yes.
But I mean, I feel that thinness should be generic on, you know.
Yeah, but exactly. But the thing is, Simeon Filip has proved that it's equivalent to be in this setting, to be thin and thick, is equivalent to have equality or inequality.
Oh, that's been proved now.
Yeah.
Oh, wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And so now the game is to try to show some thinness, and the idea is to, so in the what Chris and Thomas did is to show some free decomposition of the monodromy groups. And so, if you remember the first group that I showed, so the theorem of Brad and Thomas is, if I want to be more specific, is the subgroup generated by these two matrices. Actually, you can decompose it as, so it's isomorphic to Z and a free group of Z with Z over 5Z.
Except the order is opposite.
The order?
But you load the generators in one order, but the decomposition in the opposite order.
Ah, okay, yeah.
But you can say the first matrix is over 5.
Ah, yeah, okay, but maybe the isomorphic thing.
So it's not an obvious isomorphic.
Yeah,
sure.
And this is the reason why it's thin in this case. And so what we were trying to do with Simeon is just to. And of course, the proof of this theorem relies on some ping pong arguments. And so, yeah. The idea is that when you want to find some free product in a group, you see like when you have hyperbolic geometry, what you do usually if you want to show that two hyperbolic maps are free, you want to find some domains such that one map sends everything outside of this part to this small part, and the other map sends everything outside of this part to this small part. Okay, and so if you manage to show this, then you know that when you have like F and G are free in the. And so in a more general setting, you want to do this kind of thing where you want to make matrices, so the monodromy matrices act on some space, and try to show this kind of thing that one matrix is sending everything to like some subspace, and the other matrix is sending everything else to the subspace. Yeah. I don't want to go into too much but. The nice part is that so we have some dynamical limitation on how to find these ping pong domains, and I have a nice picture that I can show you but on the computer because the camera is not working. But that's where we start. Here the dynamics is first a way to find some new examples of thin groups, monodromy groups, but also a way to, it also gives a way to show that, to show the thinness of these groups by providing some ping pong domains.
questions?
Well, we already discussed this, but you were gone.
Yeah.
So it might even be a question to you. So what he said when you were gone is that this guy Filip proved that this inequality is an equality if and only if the group is thin, so infinite colon. And then the other case is, well, when it's strict, and then it's a finite colon. And there are some things in Margulis about these finite colon groups, which are all basically perfect, I guess, at the time, basically. Well, no, but what you have here, you have continuous parameters. So you don't always, I mean, if you ask me for R, I guess.
Sorry?
Over here on this picture where you have continuous parameters, you actually have SP4R as the target, or SP4C?
No, SP4R.
SP4R, okay. Yes. So, I mean, there's a generalization depending on the parameters.
Okay.
And what I'm puzzled about is I thought arithmetic groups should be kind of rare, so that should be the non-generic situation. And this seems to be saying the generic situation is things of infinite colon. So what really do these Margulis theorems say?
Generic depends on selection.
And
yeah.
Person to ask. So there's no one around here who knows these Margulis theorems.
But on the other hand, this inequality suggests that there's an inequality of some extra term, which happens to be zero or... Is it how it's proved, or is it just...
What is it?
I mean, the fact that there's an inequality suggests that there's actually some kind of equality of some extra term, which is not that. Which happens to be zero in the case when covariance is... is it how it is proved, or is there like a full chronological formula which gives you the sum? Or is it just really just the report?
That's a good question. So the way Simeon shows it is there are different proofs. So Simeon's proof is not published yet, so I'm not sure I can explain anything about it. But there is a proof of the one and the net who use cohomology.
To me, the obvious difference between finding this in covariance is that the portion is compact with H2, whereas it's not compact without H2. That could just explain the
okay.
So we should make the paper.
Compact is actually the same as finding covariance.
No, not the same, but just a lot. But it might be compact in this case. I don't know.
No, in fact, that's how essentially in the thin examples that we found, we want them all as some kind of basically free products.
Uh-huh.
They're almost free groups. And so they only have H1.
Uh-huh.
And so they can't be a fine equivalent for this reason. Yeah, okay. It's because the cohomology.
But that's got something to do with H2, right?
What's that?
It does have something to do with H2s.
Well, I mean, a proof of thinness is that there was no H2 there.
Okay. So my potential kind of not too far off. Anyway,
thank you.
Yeah.
No, I mean, compactness is not the issue. So one of these theorems of Margulis, like I said, is the
I blew it.
Once the D group.